All right, we are live. Welcome everybody to the second episode of Blood, Sweat, and Indie Effects, the show where we talk to independent effects artists. And I want to welcome our second guest, Sandy Collora. Sandy, how are you doing?
I'm good, Collier. I'm great. Who was the first guest? I didn't catch the first show.
It was an independent artist out of Ireland. Her name was Rachel Croak. She's just starting out, but I'm pretty sure she's gonna go places.
Well, that's good. It's good that you're supporting the gals. I don't think the gals in our industry get enough play. That's good.
Well, it is. So, Sandy, tell us about yourself. Where did you get started in effects, and tell us about your whole career? I'm sure everyone wants to know.
Oh, well, I mean, God, it's been written about and talked about so much. How do I say it differently? I was just a fan of this stuff, like yourself, I'm sure, for quite a while. I grew up playing Dungeons and Dragons and reading comic books and heavy metal magazine and just really into science fiction and horror films. And, I just followed my passion and my dream, you know, and I eventually wound up in California at 17 when I graduated from high school. And shortly after that, I wound up at Stan Winston's studio as an intern on Leviathan and Alien Nation were the first two shows I worked on. So that was how I got my start. Those were my humble beginnings.
Yes.
And then after that, I went on to work with Steve Johnson on The Abyss briefly, and did another stint with Stan Winston, went back for another couple of shows. I worked with Henry Alvarez quite a bit, Rob Bottin, did a little stint up at ILM, bounced around a lot and did a lot of different artistic related things. I've worked on toys, video games, theme parks, all kinds of stuff. I've been fortunate to work on a lot of different things, but it's mostly film related, and now I'm trying to focus my career on two things. The educational aspect of it with writing the books and, pushing my independent film career forward.
And can you give us some of the highlights of over your career? Because it sounds like you had a crazy ride over the all this.
Yeah,
time.
I've been 30 years. Yeah. Highlights. God, there's so many of them. Meeting Henry Alvarez and having him take me under his wing was huge. I mean, I had so much respect for the guy at the time. And, he had quite a few young artists approaching him at that time for internships and for training, and he didn't accept a lot of people, so to be one of the very, very, very few people that he brought into his studio and actually trained, that was definitely a highlight. Working with Rick Baker on Men in Black was another highlight. I don't know if you've heard this story or not, but it's in the Behind the Mask documentary. Rick called me personally. I picked up the phone. He said, "Hi, Sandy there." I said, "Yeah, Sandy. This is Rick Baker." I said, "Yeah, right. Who's this?" He's like, "No, this is Rick Baker." He said, "I want you to come work on Men in Black." And I said, "Oh, do you now?" I still didn't think it was him. But anyway, so that's the long part of the story. But I go there, and he invites me into this big conference room. And Steve Wang is in there, Jordu Shell, the late great Moto Hata was in there, Carlos Guante, Miles Tevis, some of the most incredibly, the cream of the crop, the most talented creature designers in the business. And that was a big moment for me, for Rick to include me in that group of designers to design for that show was pretty special. Not much of what I did got used. I think Carlos and Jose Fernandez designed most of the stuff that they actually used in the film. But it was fun to be there, for that short period of time and do some designs and a maquette or two. And it was fun. So that was a highlight as well.
So speaking of maquettes and stuff like all crazy stuff like that, what are some of your preferred mediums when it comes to this creative stuff?
Well, I do sculpt a lot of maquettes, and recently in the past couple of years, I've really become enamored with monster clay. So that is something that I'm using quite a bit. For a while, it was exclusively Super Sculpey. Back in the day, in the 80s, the mid 80s into the, you know, early 90s, there was a clay around called Roma Plastilina. You could still get it, but it's made by a different company and it's a different formula. And that stuff was like gold. If you could get your hands on Roma number 2 or Roma number 3, that was, I used to love to work in that stuff, but it's a different formula now. It's not the same. Not a big Chavant fan, although I was just at the Complete Sculptor in New York, and they asked me to do a demo there in May, and they were Chavant, I guess, was a sponsor or something like that. And Norman Cabrera, also somebody who I've looked up to in the industry for quite some time, he recommended a clay that they make called Monumelt, made by Chavant, and I just got a few bricks of it, and it seems pretty cool. So I'm looking forward to trying that out. Maybe on the next maquette I do, I'll do that. But I really like monster clay. I think Arnold's come up with a really great formula, and I like it. And that's what I've been using.
So can you talk about monster clay and why that is now your preference? And also, since you said that you used to sculpt and Super Sculpey, why did you switch to monster clay then?
Well, I wouldn't say that I've switched. I still use both, but monster clay to me is it's a really interesting hybrid between a polymer clay and an oil-based clay. It's like castelline, but better. You know, now it comes in 3 grades. You know, soft, medium, and hard, which is good. And I, you know, I just like it. I took to it very quickly. I the tool flows off it real nice. It's got all the best properties of a really creamy oil-based clay, as well as all of the great properties of some of the polymer clays like Sculpey or Fimo. So I think it's got a pretty good combination going for itself there. So I've been digging on it.
Well, thanks. Can you talk to our viewers, because we obviously are probably going to have a lot of artist people mm-hmm. watching. What is your creative process like? Because I'm sure a lot of people are curious, and people probably pick your brain about that.
It depends on what I'm doing, really. You know, if I'm designing a creature, I like to do a couple of sketches first. You know, usually I'll start with a blue pencil and just do real rough thumbnails and silhouettes and come up with shapes that I like and stuff. And then I'll take that a little further and do more detailed sketches. I like to draw on a toned paper, either a light brown or a gray tone, and then go in with inks and white colored pencils and paint and bring the highlights out and push the darks back. And then from there, I'll go to a maquette, you know, which I'll use as a model kit, or if it's for a movie, you know, I'll turn over the maquette to the director or what have you. I think it's pretty standard. I mean, I think a lot of guys work that way. Regarding my film work, I work backwards to most people that I've come across. I build the world first visually, and then I write the script. Like, everything is done in sketches first, like all the creatures, the sets, the characters, the costumes, you know. I'll do production paintings and sketches and maquettes, and I'll build the world visually first, and then I'll put all that stuff around me. And you know, literally around,
sort of use it as like inspiration.
Mm-hmm. And then I'll write the script with all that stuff in front of me. You know, and I also think about what the script is going to be while I'm sculpting or drawing or what have you. You know, so it's always in my head. But then, you know, it's the process of getting things from your head to the paper or to the screen is always the challenge for the artist. You know. Okay. It gets easier with time.
Yeah. Which, speaking of film work, what sort of sparked that change? Because a lot of people probably think, oh, you're all set with the effects stuff. And then you just, out of left field, you're like, I want to do movies. I want to make movies. What sparked that?
It wasn't really like that, actually. I always wanted to be a director, and I used effects as an inroad, which led to, you know, all different kinds of jobs, you know, working in the camera department, you know, learning about cameras and lenses and lights, and it, you know, I would work on these movies, and, you know, I was very young, obviously I didn't have a lot of experience. And it was always the more experienced guys that got to go on set. But I would say to whoever I was working with at the time, you know, hey, look, I'll come on set for free. I don't care. I want to see how movies are made, you know. And I never really let the cat out of the bag and like told people I wanted to be a director, but Stan knew. I think he figured it out, you know, and you know, Botine and all these guys, like, you know, getting to go on set for some of these movies like Jurassic Park and stuff like that was cool, you know. Watching Steven Spielberg work, watching James Cameron work, just talking to James Cameron about design. And you talk about highlights in my career. This is a little known fact. I actually got to work with James Cameron on designing the suits and stuff for Spider-Man when he was going to do that before Sam Raimi was involved. And that was a cool job. So, but yeah, I was just fortunate enough to be on set with, you know, even some of the lower budgeted guys. Like, there was a filmmaker, unfortunately he's passed on now. But he was a very Roger Corman-esque type of guy, and his name was Don Jackson. And he directed the Frogtown films, which I worked on the second one. Steve Wang did the first one, I did the second one. And I learned a lot working with him. He'd worked a lot with Cameron as well. He was a cameraman for James Cameron in the early days. And he had a lot of cool stories about Terminator and stuff like that, and them stealing shots all over LA. And Don was just a great guy that gave me a lot of opportunities and, you know, obviously not only let me build stuff, but come on set and apply makeups and you know, just do things. And you know, I learned a lot working with Don, and I know Steve did too. You know, Steve and I talk about him often, and, you know, we remember him very fondly. Just he was a really cool dude, a lot of fun to work with, you know. So, you know, you learn from everybody. You know?
That's a good tip to give out to people. And I think we are at the midpoint of the show, so I think it's time to go and give shout-outs to people that are hanging out there in the YouTube land.
How many we got?
Let's see, we got three so far, so three people watching live.
Okay.
And looks like nobody's chatting in the chat box, so for those who are going to be watching future episodes live, please chat in the chat box, and you'll get your name mentioned during the midpoint of the show. So, moving right along, I want to ask, because a lot of people you've probably gotten a lot of notoriety for doing a lot of successful Kickstarters. Can you please talk to people about that? Because that is a tricky thing that I don't feel like a lot of people, including myself, could understand.
I don't think I understand it, Collier, to be honest with you. It's an interesting question. I think I just put forth something cool and people respond to it. I haven't been as successful on Kickstarter as some of my contemporaries. I mean, guys like the Four Horsemen, you know, and, you know, the Doug Tenapel and so forth, my friends, these guys that have raised like, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars. But I can't complain. You know, I've done well. The book series is chugging along and doing well. Obviously Rubberhead did real good. You know, I raised almost $100,000 to go shoot Shallow Water, the short film. So that was fun. And you know, it's a big responsibility, and it's a lot more work than people think. And it's a lot more, of a time investment than people think, because they have a tendency to look at the screen, you know, and there's a number there that says, you know, you've successfully reached your goal of blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, you made like 90 something thousand, but like, I didn't have $90,000 and change to make the movie. I mean, I had, there's Kickstarter takes 10%, Stripe and all that other stuff, whatever that is. And then you have to make all the rewards. So you need money to burn DVDs. You need money to print posters and stills and make maquettes and paint things. And, you know, and postage is huge to send all that. I think the postage bill alone on Rubberhead was over $10,000. That just gives you an idea.
Wow.
Just the postage alone to send out, you know, almost, you know, upwards of, you know, between eight and 900 books was 10 grand or more. It was more than that, actually. So it's crazy, you know, like people, but people don't see that, you know, and they don't see a guy like John Ray behind me who's been kind enough to come and help pack books and send things. Cause I'm just so busy these days. There's always so many projects going on at one time. So, I am fortunate to have a group of people around me, not only when I make my films, but just, you know, the day-to-day stuff, the Kickstarter stuff, the, you know, just everything, you know, I have sculptors that work for me, painters. I just can't do it all myself, you know? And there's a lot of reasons for that. I think, you know, when you reach a certain point in your career, Henry Alvarez always told me this. He said, you know, you'll reach a point where you learn how to delegate more and you spend more time, you know, being a general, you know, instead of the grunt, you know. And of course I'm both. I mean, I still sculpt a lot and, you know, just draw, do whatever. But I mean, I have worked with a lot of other people, and I've been fortunate that, you know, some of these people are actually quite talented. You know, the guys and gals that help me make my films and so forth. And it's quite the little band of talented people that I've been able to amass over the years that helped me do all this stuff. I mean, some of them fall off the train and just can't handle the intensity or the schedule or me, to be honest. But you know, like you said, it's been quite the ride.
Yeah. What are some of the pitfalls that you'd say most Kickstarters run into that? Because like you said, it's more work than it seems. So
well,
can you go over that?
First of all, I don't, like you said, you know, number one, I don't think people realize how much work it is. And I don't think people put enough effort and enough research into building their page. They may have a cool product, but if you don't know how to build a cool page and present it to people, look, the whole thing about Kickstarter is getting eyes on your page. You have to have people that know about it, that not only want it, but know that it's there. And even though I've been fortunate enough to have, you know, a nice handful of successful Kickstarters, I'll still have a really good amount of people afterwards contact me and go, God, you did volume 2 or 3. I didn't know. I didn't see the Kickstarter. I didn't. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned it on Facebook a lot, you know, so for you not to see it,
yeah,
you know, it's, I don't know, like people say the Facebook algorithm has changed now and who can
see. Yeah, I've seen that, and like I heard that, yeah, they, like really 10% of your the people that are in your friends list or follow you will actually see it, unless you pay the money to.
Yeah, well, I have to boost the post on my on my fan page or whatever it is, but no, I mean it's just getting eyes on the page. And I think you have to be passionate in your video. I think you need to just be a regular person and just say, hey, look, you know, this is my product. This is, you know, I'm making iPhones or iPhone cases and I'm really excited about this and blah, blah, or whatever, you know. And I think, you know, you see too many Kickstarters that are like, hi, my name is blah, blah, blah. I've been blah, 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 blah for blah, 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 blah. and blah, 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 blah. You know, and I mean, it's boring as fuck. I mean, I don't care what they're selling. I'm not with that. You know, I want to see somebody that's excited. You know, I want to see somebody that's passionate and excited. And, you know, I've backed over 100 Kickstarter projects. So I'm very supportive of the arts, especially independent people that are doing films, toys, books, anything, any kind of art, any kind of creative endeavor, music, without any studio backing or a publisher, I'm there. You know, I want to help those people out. But, you know, obviously everybody's got limited funds. You can't help everybody, but yeah. I look for the people that are most passionate, you know, the people that are very, very passionate about what they do and that make a good product. So I think those are your top three things, you know, be passionate, make a good product and present yourself well. You know, those are the three things I think you need to do. And I think I've been fortunate in the fact that I've been able to do those well. So, you know, I've had nothing but an incredible, you know, positive response to the products. You know, Behind the Mask was very well received. All the books have been incredibly well received. My action figure projects, everything. It's just been really well received. So, you know, it just kind of builds your Kickstarter presence, so to speak. So, you know, it's like Facebook. You know, when you first get on Facebook, you have so many friends, and then, you know, after a couple of weeks, you got more friends, and then you post some cool pictures of your art, and then like, oh, you got more friends. And, you know, hopefully the same will happen with your show. You know, as you do more and you have more guests and you know, talk about it more and you get people like myself to go out there and pimp it for you, you know, hopefully you'll build up a good listenership.
Yeah. So. Well, thank you. And
sure.
Also, what is your favorite type of creature to make, and what are some creatures that you would like to make in the future?
Wow, what a great question. My favorite creatures to make are anything aquatic or reptilian. And the stuff I'd like to do in the future it would be different than that. I think it's time for me to start moving away from that and bringing my own unique style into, you know, less fish, reptilian, insectoid stuff, and maybe get into more vampires and werewolves or whatever, slugs or whatever.
Or Bigfoots.
Yeah, Bigfoot, yeah. I just sculpted a skunk ape bust. I did a little sketch while I was in New York for Brian McCrudden. If he's watching or if he sees this, maybe he'll post it. It's on my Instagram, if you go look. Just a little, it's a quick sculpty sketch I did of a skunk ape. You'll like it. Okay, but yeah, cool. So that's more the direction, I think. You know, I mean, look, you know, I'll always do, I mean, look, my style's my style, right? I mean, you can't really change it now. I mean, 30 years in, but I think it would be interesting to take my style and, you know, explore different types of designs. I think, it happens to everybody. I mean, the greats, you know, Carlos Wante and, you know, Norman Cabrera and Steve Wang and these guys. I mean, you know, Jordu, you know, the stuff is amazing, but you look at it and you know, okay, that's Jordu, that's Steve, that's whatever, you know, and we all of our work has such a signature to it. But I think we're all trying anyway, you know, to change a little bit and do different things. You know, and it's hard because when you're a guy like Steve Wang or you're a guy like Carlos Wante or myself, you know, people expect that from you. They expect that style. They expect the cool sea creature from Sandy. You know, they expect, you know, the amazing paint job from Steve, and they expect that, you know, that real organic musculature coolness from Carlos. You know, it's like that's just what you expect from those guys. You expect like the cool buggy, weird, like Jordu stuff, you know, like that's what people like about the different artists' work. So, you know, I watch a James Cameron movie because I know his style and I know what I'm going to see. Same thing with, you know, with a Ridley Scott movie or, you know, David Fincher, you know, artists. You know, I listen to Prince because I love Prince. I love his style. I love his music. I listen to The Doors, because I love Jim Morrison. I love his style. I love the way he sings. I love, you know, the lyrics. I mean, people are drawn to artistic people for their art. So I think when they deviate too much, it's not good. So you have to find that niche of like reinventing yourself while still being who you are. You know, and I think somebody like Madonna has been very successful at that over the years. Prince, Michael Jackson, you look at what they've done, and it's, you know, Prince was always Prince, whether he was the artist formerly known as Prince or whatever. I mean, but you know, you listen to the music and it's always Prince. To where, like, you take a band like Metallica, and I think for a while they fell off the ledge into the abyss. I mean, what were some of those albums? Like, really? Like, they all cut their hair short and went in a different direction, and it was too much. It wasn't Metallica, you know? So I think they lost a bit of their fan base there. So, you know, you're always trying to find a way to be relevant, you know? And it's good that we have each other to bounce all this off of. You know, Steve and I talk about this, and Eddie Yang, and I talk to Mike Hill about it all the time. And, you know, other artists, you know, my studio mates, Mike Kels, Rush, you know, Russ Campbell. I mean, you know, all the guys that I'm around here with all the time. I mean, we'll always talk about style and presentation and how to change things up when we're making these books and doing these things. And you know, they're all really great conversations. And I think it's important for artists to talk to other artists and be around other art and other artists, not only to be inspired, but to get opinions and get feedback.
Yeah.
So that's a very long-winded answer, but
yeah. That's all right. That was a very good answer for that sort of question. Mm-hmm. Also, another question is, I'm sure a lot of people have known you for this, that you've been making this project for a while, that you've been, this has been a passion project for you. Is there anything you can talk about involving Shallow Water?
Other than the fact that it nearly killed me, literally, no. To be honest with you, Collier, I think I've put enough out there. As a matter of fact, I think I've shown the creature too much. I think if this film lands with as hollow of a thud as the trailer did, I'm going to be in trouble, because, you know, I've been promising everybody this great film for, you know, 3 years now. But it is very different from the trailer. It's completely different.
The trailer is supposed to tease people.
Yeah. Well, the trailer was a whole different animal. This is a very different thing. I feel it's my best work as a filmmaker. I'm super proud of it. I'm super proud of my cast and my crew. Lisa Romaine, my actress, was fantastic. My creature guys were great. It was hard. It was a really tough shoot and a tough project to do for the budget. And I think when people see it, they're going to be really shocked at what I was able to do for the money. And I hope, everybody likes it. I mean, I'm not one of these pretentious artists or filmmakers that's like, well, I'm an artiste and I just do my art and I don't give a shit who likes it. You know, I mean, of course I want people to like my work. Yes. I want to do more of it, you know. So this is going to be big. It's going to debut at Monsterpalooza. I think that's a great venue for it. Elliot Brodsky, the promoter of that show, was kind enough to give us the best spot in the house. We're showing on Saturday, April 8th at 5:00. So we're going to show the film. We're going to have a Q&A with myself and Lisa and some of the other people that worked on the film. And then we're going to do a signing at my booth. There's going to be free posters and stills and stuff like that. So it'll be cool. I mean, and hopefully people will love it. I just showed it to my buddy John here, who came over and is helping me, you know, pack and ship the Kickstarter stuff. And I think it's safe to say he was pretty blown away. So that's a good sign.
I think it's pretty safe to say a lot of people that are following you are going to be pretty blown away.
I hope so. Let's hope for the best. And, you know, when you do something artistic or creative, whether it be a sculpture or a painting or a film, you know, once you're done with it, it's not yours anymore. It becomes the audience's, you know, and it becomes, in essence, their property. It becomes part of them, and they are the ones who choose to make it something that's either lauded or not, you know, very highly praised or not. I've been fortunate in my career with, you know, I don't know, 75-80% of my stuff to fall into that category. I've had a lot of good fortune in my career. A lot of talented people have helped me achieve different degrees of success in different areas of this industry. And I couldn't have done it without them. Henry Alvarez and I learned so much from Stan Winston and Steve Wang and just people that have imparted their knowledge and their wisdom on me and shown me techniques, Mike Hill, Darren Roberts. I mean, all these artists that I've been fortunate enough to collaborate with over the years. And, you know, my film crews as well, you know, all my DPs, you know, Ed Gutentag, Felipe Perez, Vince Toto, my costume designer, Michael McFarlane, my actors, Clark Bartram, Mike O'Hearn, Lisa Romaine. I mean, just, you know, the list goes on and on and on. Kurt Carley, Jason Lyles, all these people, the late Andrew Koenig, who I think hit it out of the park as the Joker. You know, I've just been fortunate, you know, and if I knew how to do it, I'd tell you. Like, if I knew what the formula was, yeah, I'd tell you. But, you know, even I don't hit a home run every time. I mean, you know, look, you know, Hunter Prey really wasn't that well received. I mean, domestically, foreign, it went gangbusters, which was great.
I loved Hunter Prey.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And, no, it definitely has its audience, for sure. I mean, it definitely found its niche audience, but it didn't blow up like Dead End. You know, I mean, it was not that popular, but, yeah. But thank you. No, it does have its audience, but it's mostly foreign. The film is very popular in Europe and it's very popular in Japan. You know, even the trailer that we shot for Shallow Water, you know, I thought that was going to be enough of a proof of concept, to raise the money to go make the feature, and it just wasn't. Like, it just didn't resonate with people. People were kind of like, it's not bad, but it's not good. You know, like, they just, it, and I was like, you know, like, what do you do now? You know, and you have to reinvent it, which is what I think I've done. So, I'm excited to show everybody the film.
All right. Well, we are all looking forward to it, I'm sure. And, mm-hmm. I guess trying to be as patient as we can. Can you impart a bit of knowledge, advice onto some of the newer guys that are wanting to do the sort of stuff, be it creature design or filmmaking or whatever they have a passion for? Do you have any advice for them or words of wisdom?
Well, I do. And when I was young and first getting into this business, I drew a lot of parallels from sports. I played sports as a kid. I was a baseball player. I played football. I played lacrosse. Played a little bit of soccer. But mostly football and baseball. And I was a big Pete Rose fan. I was a big Tom Seaver fan. You know, the Giants, when I was a kid from, you know, the mid 80s, you know, the Lawrence Taylor, Phil Sims, Bill Parcells team, always a huge Michael Jordan fan. And I drew inspiration from them. I drew inspiration from guys like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I've always been into fitness and, you know, keeping my body in shape and I've been inspired by them. So I think it's important to be inspired by other people besides artists. Which I've certainly been inspired by quite a few. I think you see it in my work. You know, I think, you know, I wear my influences on my sleeve. James Cameron, Ridley Scott, Fincher. Lately, Inarritu, I was a big fan of The Revenant. I think you have to draw inspiration from everywhere. And you have to be passionate about what you're doing, and you cannot do anything half-assed. You have to... You have to attack every project and everything you do with the ferocity and a tenacity that you're not going to let it go until it's the absolute best that it could be, no matter what it is. And you know what? You'll look back on it in a year or 2 years or 5 years and go, oh my God, what a piece of crap. But that's normal. That's supposed to happen. You're supposed to progress. I look at work that I did 5 years ago. Ugh. You know, even Batman Dead End, which till this day is still so revered. You know, I look, God, like if I would have made that movie now, it'd be 10 times better, you know, but that was the best movie that I could make at that time. You know, and that's what shallow water is. Shallow water is indicative of the absolute best film I could make at this point in the artistic development of Sandy Collora. So you know, you're getting 100% of me when you watch this film. And I think that's what it takes to succeed. And I think that's the number one thing, even more so than my talent, to be brutally honest, that's made me successful, is the fact that I've never given up and I've always given 100% in everything that I do. And again, not everything I've done has been successful. I've had my share of failures as well. And you have to learn from those and move on. In essence, I mean, they're actually just as important as the successes. You know, you have to be able to learn from failure and pull yourself back up and go, okay, I saw what I did wrong here. I'm not going to do that again. I'm going to try something different, you know? And you know, I think you only become like, you know, a real loser when you keep making the same mistakes over and over again, you know, which I haven't done. You know, you learn from mistakes that you've made or a certain technique that you used didn't work, or working with a certain person didn't work or whatever, and you have to change it and move on. And you see your work grow. And I think if the work isn't growing, whether it's, you know, you're a creature designer or a sculptor or an animator or a puppeteer or a toy maker or a filmmaker or whatever you're doing, you need to strive to be the best that you can be at that particular thing. And I think it's important not to try and be better than anyone else. Just be the best you that you can be. You know what I mean? I wake up every morning and I look in the mirror and I say to myself, how can I be the best Sandy Collora I can be today? And it sounds super corny, and I'm sure there's people that listen to this, you know, rolling their eyes going, oh, there he goes with the Tony Robbins shit again. But
yeah, but totally, there's a reason, like it's also been said before, there's a reason it's a cliche, is because it's true.
Yes, yeah. So I think that's my advice to young people is don't be too entitled. Don't be too impatient. Stick with it. Listen to some of the older, more experienced guys that have been there and have walked in the path that you're about to embark on. And they can impart a lot of knowledge on you. So I admire you for doing this show and having people on like myself or whoever that are going to put things out there for people that hopefully help them. So in other words, you're doing your part, not only as an artist, but as somebody that's helping share and spread knowledge and spread talent. And I commend you for that. I think that's fantastic.
Well, thank you.
That's why I like you, even though you love the shit out of me. I think you're a good kid, Collier, and I think you got some talent, and I think what you're doing is good, and I support you 100%.
Well, thank you. Yeah, that's going to be the point of the show. I want to, along with getting shows with the big guys like you, I want to also get shows with some of the guys that are sort of, I guess, on my level, just starting, whatever. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
As long as they have the promise and the talent. Because we want to get people that deserve it out there. And I guess we are getting to the point where we are almost
wrapped up. This isn't an industry that does that, by the way. Just so you know, this is not an industry that caters to the people who deserve things. You have to go out and get it. You really have to, you know.
Yeah. You have to knock down the doors.
And sometimes you got to knock down some people.
No, of course.
You know, I've done that too. So I've done my share of knocking people down. You know, just
something you have to do
is what it is. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. But that's just, there's your words of wisdom from the Sandman for this evening.
Okay. So there's the moral of the story, kids, and we are getting to where we're, starting to wrap up. So, please, Sandy, tell people where they can find you on social media, on the internet, where, how they can contact you if they want to come to you for advice or see your work.
The best place is Facebook, you know, just under Sandy Collora on Facebook. Just follow me on Facebook. My page is public, so anybody can look at it and keep up to date. My Instagram is Collora Studios. And my website, where you can order my books and my art and other things and stickers and t-shirts and stuff like that, is montaukstudios.com. That's M-O-N-T-A-U-K studios.com. And that's about it. And just keep the Art of Shallow Water book is dropping soon. That'll be out in a couple weeks here. The movie is pretty much finished. I got a few more little tweaks to make. So though, as soon as I get the DVDs and the Blu-rays made, those will get shipped out shortly. And me and John here are going to be shipping machines over the next month or two. So everybody's going to be getting a lot of cool care packages from the Sandman over the next 30 to 60 days. So it should be a good thing.
All right, and we are all looking forward to it. Please, everybody, go to Facebook and support Sandy. Keep an eye out because I'm sure he's got more projects down the line.
Mm-hmm. Always.
You got to keep an eye on this guy. He's always up to something. And we're all waiting. We're anticipating a Shallow Water. And
Good.
So
I'll send you a DVD or a Blu-ray. You'll have to tell me what you think. I'd be curious to see what you think of it.
I can't wait, man.
Good.
But for those of you who really like this show, please hit us, hit the like button and comment below. Tell us what you think. Please subscribe and hit the bell notification so that way you are notified every time we have a new episode of Blood, Sweat, and Indie Effects. We hopefully will have another show up next Thursday, and please keep up to date with us. And everybody, have a good night.
Thanks.